Okay, I guess we'll start. So thanks for coming this evening. I know there's problems with the train at the moment, perennial strikes in London. My name is Paul Goodwin. I'm director of TrAIN, Research Centre for Transnational Art, Identity and Nation. And this is part of our ongoing TrAIN Open Lecture Series, which is our flagship lecture series. We have one a month. And if you're not part of the TrAIN mailing list, please sign up. Feedback forms so you can be informed of future events. Tonight we're really pleased and excited to welcome back Dr. Azadeh Fatehrad, who is a graduate of Chelsea College of Art and is an artist and curator based in London. Dr. Fatehrad's research engages with feminist history of Iran from the turn of the century to the present. Her projects explore still and moving image and archives, investigating the ways in which feminist movement has expanded across the, particularly the urban middle class women in her home country of Iran. Her research, artistic and curatorial practice, often based around a process of gathering information and generating new imagery in response to the archival material that she discovers. And she's made an extensive use of archival material, including those held at institutions such as the Weltkulturmuseum in Frankfurt, the International Institute for Social History in Amsterdam, and the Institute for Iranian Contemporary Historical Studies in Tehran. This research and this body of knowledge has allowed her, this process, to develop new insights into Iran's women's movement and to devise a series of periodic programs, including exhibitions, conferences, and workshops, including, for example, an exhibition at the showroom in London called Hengame Golestan, I'm sure I pronounced that wrong, Witness 1979, as well as an exhibition at the Apsis in Stockholm, the Feminist Historiography, and she presented at many conferences around the country and internationally. Tonight, Dr. Fatehrad's lecture is called Photography, Desire, and Resistance in the Lives of Women Following the 1979 Revolution in Iran. As usual, Dr. Fatehrad will speak for around 35 to 40 minutes, and I'll open that up to the floor for questions and conversation. So without further ado, please welcome Dr. Azadeh Fatehrad. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Paul, for your kind introduction, and thank you so much for Chelsea College of Art for having me here, and also TrAIN, Louise Bauer, and it's a great pleasure to share with you my project, and I'm also thankful for Dr. Malcolm Queen and David DeBosa for their long-term support developing my project in the last 5 years, especially during my Emirates at the Chelsea College. It is wonderful to see you here. It's cold outside, but thank you for coming. The story of my PhD at RCA started from this room. I was attending a TrAIN lecture 6 years ago, and it was a book launch of a German artist called Sandra Schaefer. And that time I was doing my MA at Chelsea, and I was flipping through her book, and I saw a photo which I'm going to show you here.
Is it possible to put the light
down?
No.
Oh, yeah, sorry. And maybe I'll close that door. This is a lot of coming in. Sorry. Okay. lunch in the same lecture theater, and it was a German artist. When I flipped through her book, I saw this photo. If you see on the back of the image, there is a slogan written in Farsi, and I didn't know about it. So I asked Sandra, is that Iran? Is that written in Farsi? And she said, yes, the photographer is sitting in the audience. So go and talk with her. So that was the first time I met Hengam Megulistan, and that was somehow the beginning of my curiosity to know more about this this image, which is taken by Hengam Megulistan on the 8th of March 1979, the International Women Day in Tehran. This is actually one of the most significant days in the history of feminism, which I will talk with you about it in a little while. But I wanted you to know that this was how everything started in the last 6 years. It started same in this location with the same research center TrAIN. And I want to share with you my journey through this research and perhaps provide you with an insight to how artists could contribute to a lost or written history, how could personal, analytical, and imaginary provide a different way of looking at time, past, present, or socio-political concern. The ways in which artistic production could reflect to an existing or missing part of history. I have prepared a paper that could keep me on time. It will be about 35-40 minutes, as Paul kindly noted. Said, if you have any question in the through the presentation, please feel free to interrupt. It's an intimate group, so we can have a discussion as we go, and it's a pleasure to see you here, and also familiar faces. Thank you for coming. My research, curatorial, and artistic practice are all intertwined around the process of gathering information and generating new imagery from a still and moving image archives that I discovered. My multidisciplinary practice ranges from still and moving images to fictional stories, short films, artist books, and performance. I was greatly influenced by an image of the 1979 Iranian Revolution, which was the driving impetus behind my practice-based research at the RCA. The photo, as you can see here, is captured one of the most important days in the history of feminism in Iran, when just after 24 days of Iranian Revolution, a compulsory hijab was announced and a revolt within the revolution took place. I should note here that there is an extreme difference of context of veiling in Iranian culture than other parts of the Middle East. The grandmother of some of the women I interviewed as part of this project have been traditionally or religiously veiled in their youth, forcibly unveiled in 1935 by Reza Shah government edict, which you might be familiar with this history. It's similar to Ataturk in Turkey. They ban traditional clothing as a sign of modernization of society. And then those women have been compulsory reveiled in 1979 by the Islamic government. So the very act of wearing the veil, as has been imposed, withdrawn, and reimposed within a single lifetime. This specific history of Iranian women has led to a fraught relationship with the practice of veiling that is far from peaceful. I should add that myself, having lived within Iranian Shi'i Islamic ideology and with Iranian historical and culturally specific compulsory unveiling and reveiling, and also being a Middle Eastern woman living in a Western diasporic context, I have to declare that writing about the subject of the veil has been one of the most challenging through my writing process. I have experienced several concerns in writing about the veil in general. For instance, the dilemma of recognizing the history of women's struggle to be veiled as well as to be veilless in Iran. My tension about inevitably contributing to Orientalist fetishist views of the veil and women who veil and the flat stereotypes of women who come from the Orient. In my case, which Western media focus is on Islamic fundamentalists during the last three decades. I was fascinated by this photo and the spontaneity of this demonstration, which I'm going to tell you more about it today in a short while. I was very curious to find out more about myself and about the women of my society. For this project, you will notice that I have adopted a cross-cultural approach throughout this historical research, looking at the artistic, social, aesthetic, and political implication of the existing images and their relation to life today. Is any of you here from Fine Arts, Chelsea, MA? You?
Graduate diploma.
Oh, fantastic.
That works, right?
So the found image, the one we just saw, and this was the starting point for every image of the past that is not recognized by the present as one of its own concerns, threatens to disappear relatively. Here I have figure one, which is 1979 Iran Revolution, and I have figure two, 1983 in post-revolution in Iran, which when the compulsory verdict was in place. Figure one and two present a historical narrative of women's appearance in post-revolutionary Iran. These are typical scenes that people like myself growing up in Iran at the time would often come across. The anniversary of the Iranian Revolution, which falls in winter and is known as Bahman 22nd, sees the various media channels broadcasting images of victory in Iran to help the new generations learn about the event. That is how I learned the sequence of events in my country's history. Figure one on the right side of the image, taken during the 1979 revolution itself, when men and women stood against the Shah's regime to try to establish a more democratic country. They fought together for one united aim, and that was to essentially topple Reza Shah's government. As you can see, there is a mix of different fashions visible in the image, both a scarfed and unscarfed woman wearing long skirts, jeans, and other attire. In contrast, a very clear uniform can be seen, worn by all the women in the second photograph, the black from head to toe, which now represent the Islamic State of Iran. This image was taken after the establishment of the Islamic Republic in Iran, which was 1979, but there was a gap between the moment the compulsory dress code was announced and the moment that was actually imposed. So by looking at these two images, it is understandable how one might assume there was simply a change between uncovered and covered women. The missing part of this narrative is that the transition was far from smooth and that a six-day demonstration, in fact, took place against the new government. A revolt within the revolution took place. Here is the missing photograph in this narrative. One can see a large crowd demonstrating on the streets of Tehran. This significant demonstration, which saw about 100,000 men and women marching in the streets of Tehran spontaneously, continued for 6 days. It is considered one of the most important movements in the history of feminism in Iran. During the first few days, women were just using small pieces of paper to write their very rudimentary slogans on. But by days four and five, they were using curtains and marker pens and being far more effective. As some of you may know, on the 8th of March, 1979, just 24 days after the Iranian Revolution, the compulsory dress code for women was announced by Ayatollah Khomeini. Soon after the revolution, there were in fact rumors of plans for the reintroduction of the hijab and the abolition of several women's rights, which had previously been protected by the Family Protection Act, the reasons being that they were seen as against Islam. Now I'm going to show you a short video about the demonstration that is the only video documentation of this event. It was filmed by a French journalist group, which is called Practic Politique et Psychoanalyse, who documented the protest using a 60mm camera and also conducted interviews with the demonstrators. So I'm going to show you a brief section of this video.
Voyez les femmes chaudes du sec. La naissance d'un mouvement de libération des femmes dans le pays islamique. Dès le premier jour, et pendant toute une semaine de révolution des femmes, quatre d'entre nous étaient avec elles dans les rues. Manifestations, cités, discussions, réunions. Et nous étions nombreuses à Paris, Lyon, Bordeaux, Marseille et d'autres villes à mettre toutes nos forces à faire connaître leur mouvement. Nous avons transmis jour après jour leur révolte, leur fête, leur violence, leur victoire. Nous, les femmes du mouvement de libération des femmes, pratique politique et psychanalyse, qui affirmons que quand des femmes iraniennes brisent leurs chaînes, ce sont des femmes du monde entier qui avancent avec elles.
For keeping the time, I stop here, but I will provide you with my email for any of the links that I'm going to show you tonight. So if you would like to see, just drop me a line and I'll forward it for you for that you can see all the video whenever you want. Even though the national media largely ignored what was happening, the event attracted a great deal of international press attention. The movement was greatly supported and joined by feminists from France, Germany, Egypt, and many other countries, all of whom were anxious to lend their support to Iranian women. This led to the creation of a solidarity committee, which was led by Simone de Beauvoir. This is the image of the F magazine. There is a very comprehensive account of this event by two Iranian authors. They are based in Paris, Mahnaz Matin and Nasser Mohajer. It's called the Women's Demonstration, Uprising of Women 1979, Jumbesh Zanan, Dar Sale 1357. That was a Farsi version afterwards, I just repeated the sentence. If you would like, it's published by Nocte Publication and could be accessible online. Just again, I will provide you with the email whenever you you're keen and finding about the attempt. Let me know. And also at the time of this protest, the American feminist author Kate Miller was in Iran attending a conference at Tehran University for International Women's Day on March 8th. Here is a short video of her among demonstration.
J'ai été impressionnée par la ferveur et le courage des femmes. Je n'ai jamais vu des femmes qui s'organisent aussi rapidement et en aussi grand nombre. Il y a 10, 15 000 femmes dans ces manifestations. Aux États-Unis, ça prendrait des années pour se rassembler comme ça. Il faudrait de l'argent, il faudrait écrire aux gens, il faudrait de la publicité. Ici, quelqu'une brandit un panneau pendant la manifestation avec « sit-in à la télévision » ou bien « demain au ministère de la Justice ». Et tout le monde y va. Parce que ces femmes non seulement ont été réprimées pendant très très longtemps, mais ce sont aussi des femmes qui ont fait la révolution. Elles ont été dans les rues, elles savaient qu'elles-mêmes pouvaient être tuées par le chat et ses troupes. Ce sont celles qui ont eu le courage de sortir face au char, le courage de se soulever. Et beaucoup de femmes m'ont dit que pour leurs droits, elles pourraient se faire tuer, ça ne fait rien, la lutte doit continuer. Je n'ai jamais entendu des féministes dire des choses pareilles.
Oh,
as you could see, she stated that she was extremely impressed by the women's uprising, noting in her interview that in America, a demonstration of that scale would require many years of planning and writing to women to try and persuade them to take part. This had never happened before in the history of feminism. Can you hear me all right on the back? Yeah? All right, that was the story of my found image. I became fascinated with this image and I wanted to know more than what was immediately or stereotypically available. I wanted to know more about myself, about my woman of my society. And the exciting part here began. I embarked on a PhD practice space at the Royal College of Art to pursue my passion and enthusiasm. I should also tell you that my encounter with a photograph of the women's uprising in Iran in 1979, taken by Hengame Golestan, took place here at this lecture theater. I said that in the beginning, but just repeating again. During my MA, being an artist, researcher, and curator enabled me to create, respond to, and restage the historical material with my new findings. That was the image I was talking about. I started to do a series of fieldwork and research to articulate a more precise narrative of this woman uprising. I received funding from the RCA to travel to Berlin and invest on an archive which is held there for feminist movement of Iran in diaspora. This is the archive. It's called Archive for Forschung and Documentation Berlin. Apologies if German speakers are sitting in the audience. This photo is from, Berlin, 2013. During those 6 days demonstration of 1979, indeed a community took shape to lead the activities. That was called National Unity of Women, Anjumane Milli Zana, that I just translated the Farsi. One of the founding members of the community had created this archive in Berlin to preserve the documents, as well as providing source for researcher and public programs and women in diaspora, feminist activities in diaspora. Here you can see the shelves are full of documents here. This is Shahin Nawawi, one of the founding members in the archive. Here you can see the shelves of the archive, full of documents, letter, newspaper, as well as the magazines which were published by them during those years. The life span of the National Unity of Women began on the 8th of March 1979 to April 1983, when the enforcement of the dress code was in full force, and ultimately the members had to escape to countries such as immigrating to Berlin, England, USA, and Sweden, among others. These are some of the images. As part of my project, I did a series of interviews with Shahin Nawawi, that's the lady on the photo, to record her insights of that 6 days demonstration, as well as the activities they did during those time. I have prepared for you an extract of the interview that we can look at it together briefly.
Repression, a lot of women had to bring the issue even repression of the Iranian society against women, and they got involved naturally during the time of the revolution, as you know pretty well, that that the Iranian women very fast they react to this reactionary regime of the especially to the reactionary religious leader, Khomeini, that he wanted the women to go to the war with the Islamic hijab. And that was the first reaction, and that was the first step that the Iranian women just noticed that it's a very serious issue, especially the women that they were active in the society. And in this time, it was not only that the women from the civil or from the laic family that they were active. Also, a lot of these religious people that before they didn't let them any possibility to go out and to get involved in the politics. They brought them to the street. And we saw also later on, we just continue, that they became also to realize that how the family law, how the family code in Iran is against the women. And that was more maybe for them, this awareness to help than the middle class, or the intellectual or the educated women. Mm-hmm. But the educated women, they can more or less, they can find their way mm-hmm. faster or maybe better, not always, but most of the cases.
Yeah.
And that was the situation that
here, if you don't mind, just to keep me on time. But again, if you're interested, I will have my email at the end of the presentation. She is talking, actually, it's very super interesting about their activities during that time. For me, which I was not aware of what happened, was a very great insight to find somebody which was actually part of that demonstration or part of that organizing committee. And here, her own voice about what they have done during that time. Yes.
She went into exile.
She lives in Berlin since. Yes, in Berlin. There are many Iranians who live in Berlin. Many Iranians live here in Sweden and also in America. I could visit her archive, and it's open to public. You just need to drop a line for her if you want to be there and use the archive. It's free. There is a donation pot you can donate to keep them going. And it's a fantastic material. It's in Farsi, majority of the material, so you probably need to go with someone that could help you find in your sources. Some of the editors are provided in English, but not all of them, unfortunately. It's good for Farsi speakers who want to know about the history and the diaspora. Okay, some of the images from there, yes. So the photo of Hengamakolistan, which we saw in earlier, I started to work with that. I started to work with the photographs, and in collaboration with the showroom in London, I started to illustrate the happening in a form of an exhibition. Here you can see that I traveled back to Tehran with the photojournalist Hengamakolistan to visit her archive. We chose together a few negatives, as you can see here. It was a lots of roll of negative that she took photo on that day. I encountered one photo here in this room, but I wanted to see what other availabilities are and what I could curate a show out of it. So here we were looking at the options, and we chose some of the photos. I tried to scan them and also use different form of printing. Some of them on a vinyl print that goes on the wall, and also she's very traditional photographer, so it was important for me to keep the quality of a fine art print photographs. So there was a mix of a print to be presented on the wall. Here you can see test images that we were deciding which one in which photo could come out very well. Here is the showroom space. I'm sure you're all familiar with showroom, right? You have been at the showroom, right? No? Okay, showroom is a non-profit space located in Edgware Road. It's a very sort of mixed Middle Eastern area of London. Definitely you know that. So it's a very much community-based space. It's to do with neighborhood and working with the community around the showroom itself. It's not a wide queue. It's a platform for discussion. So here you can see we were deciding for what size. This is the interior of the showroom. We are deciding for what size, how many goes on the wall, and then of course there are some billboards outside on the wall, which primarily showroom uses this size of the print to go on the wall. For me, it was super important to scale the images up as much as I can to communicate with the neighborhood, as even when the gallery space is closed. So after many times going back and forth, eventually I convinced the showroom team to go that big. So I covered the full people were outside, but also we had to need to keep the cost low. So I had to find the cheapest I could to keep the cost low, but also be able to enlarge the photos. As you can see, I scanned the negative that there is a Kodak line still available on the image. So there is a reference to that negative photographs that she took in during those time. You probably know the print space in Houston Square. I know some of you are studying here, so it's a very good print space. And also, for me to obtain that size, I have to cut each of the images to three lines and then install them on the wall in one piece together with the technicians. In the middle of the space, we place the table, which includes all the sort of most of the books that has enriched my research during those years. Many of them are reference books. Raina Lewis, who also teaches at UAL. And as you can see on the corner right side of the image, there is a slideshow. I was not able to print all the images I choose, so I put few of them, which were in color, in a rolling in a loop on the slideshow, so people could be more engaged with the images. And of course, we did series of workshops. Did any of you visited the showroom Hengame Golestan exhibition? It was last September.
Pity I didn't get it because
now
I'm in there because I know Hengame.
Sure. Okay, no worries. We did a series of workshops as part of the program. Was exhibition, symposium, workshops, reading groups, and screenings. Some of the workshops were taking place inside the showroom, and some of them were outside. I hosted at the Parcel Unit Foundation in East London to cover a slightly further experimental group to develop the images, because I want to publish that book with this material. So these are some of the images of the workshop with different age group we held. A screening was took place. That is Louise Sherry on the right, on the left side of the image. I didn't have any other photo, but she's the person I collaborated to co-curate this show and produce this exhibition with her. I don't know the guy on the right side, I'm sorry. But these are the images of the symposium. If you may recognize that this Shaheen Nawai, I brought from Berlin over, and a couple of other artists, also also Sandra Schaefer, who I met in this lecture theater, who by seeing her work, my PhD began. So each of them presented, there was 2-day symposium, one in the beginning of the exhibition, one towards the end. It was a full day symposium with different speakers, Raina Lewis and Zibamir Hosseini from SOAS University. And quite a good combination of artists, and also academics and activists during those time. This is Sandra as part of the symposium on the second round. She's also based in Germany, in Hamburg. Some of the images, visual materials of the collage that was created during those sessions. We did some screening of from Lux and Cinenova at the RCA, because this was in partnership with my university, because this is my PhD project. So we did host a few events at the RCA as part of the program that also took the sort of education part of the project with the student at the RCA. It was called Hidden Face from Cinenova. And these are some of the images from the private view. It is very busy, but it was not every day like this. So just like to show you how it was well received during those days. And it was very well received by press. I had interviews, British Journal of Photography, Guardian, New York Times, Financial Times was the critique choice of the weekend, of the first weekend. I had interviews by CNN and also Euronews. This actually created the new constellation of the image, of the event which was actually now part of my history, being from Iran, became part of a larger history, became part of a larger community which exists in Britain or abroad. And then, of course, I presented this at the Sharjah Foundation in March meeting last year. It also expanded to a larger, maybe Middle Eastern or European context. So So there is a different stage in the project, which is maybe if I had a chance to do a further research, I would do that. That what happens with the image when you start to work with a missing part of the image, which maybe Hall Foster mentioned about it, and what does it become when it becomes becomes active or becomes available? It becomes part of a different narrative altogether, I think. Yeah, these are some of the copy of the press. So this is the second phase of the project. How are you doing there? Are you bored, tired? You good? Fantastic. Okay. Here, it was in this moment that I became curious to know, this is 1979, but what happened before that? Is that accurate? Why women spontaneously came to the streets and what was in stake for that? That was the moment that I visited the archive in Tehran to find out about photographic record of the early feminism in Iran, which is around 1911. After a few months of research, I was invited to International Institute of Social History in Amsterdam to work on the archive of the founding mother of the Iranian feminism, which is called Saliha Dolat Abadi. This goes back to the 20th century. As some of you may know, it was during the constitutional revolution in Iran. I'm going to show you some images first. So this image is from Tehran archive. It shows the early feminism in Iran. And yeah, the woman group activists in Iran. A school meeting in Iran, early 20s. And this is the International Institute of Social History, which I'm going to talk about it now. Yes, that's the name of the founding mother of Iranian feminism, which is considered founding mother of Iranian feminism, Sadiqeh Dolat Abadi. And what we are looking at is about the constitutional revolution, which took place 1906-11 in Iran, changed a great deal for women. It was the revolution in Iran which took place in early 20th century, and it was based on the need for representative government, educational reform, and modernization were all among the objectives of the constitutionalists. This was a great time for women's awakening. Indeed, women's education was seen as a critical part of reforms that was paved the way for the creation and development of the modern Iran. A group of educated and enlightened women, including Sadiqeh Dolat Abadi, which her archive is in Amsterdam, International Institute of Social History, played a very strong role in this time of awakening in terms of the schools and societies they founded, the articles that they wrote, and the journals they published. This is her journal. It's called Woman's Voice. In Farsi, it's written Zaban Zanan. It was printed fortnightly, and it was a mix of, she was studied in Sorbonne University, and in her return to Iran, it was what she was producing with her colleague during that time, a combination of the domestic health, domestic care, and child care for women and their education. It was distributed in their fortnightly sessions in Tehran. Well, not forgetting that I'm an artist, and in this historical research I made work in response to these archives as I go along. Here I'm going to show you a short video essay that is part of a three video piece. This is the section one. It's called Woman's Voice, taken the name from the journal of Saliha Dolat Abadi. I'm going to show you a very short video.
The The objective of the 6 days of the protest in Iran was not only to reject the compulsory dress code, but to highlight the initial purpose of the revolution, i.e. to secure greater freedom and equality for the people. The protesters were fighting for equal pay for men and women and for freedom of the press, speech and assembly. The aim of this remarkable spontaneous protest, the first of its kind in the feminist history of Iran and indeed the world, was to protect the rights and autonomy of women away from the authority of the men who sought to force them to cover.
In collaboration with the International Institute of Social History, where these archives are held, I curated an exhibition in Amsterdam titled Iran's Women's Movement, showcasing some of the original archives as well as my photographs and video in response to this material. 5 channel video and different prints of photographs are displayed in this exhibition. Were displayed in this exhibition last February. Iran's Women Movement started 7th of March, finished on the 8th of March 2016. This is the interior of the show. As you can see, some of the videos we were just watching together today. An installation of some of the photos on the wall. Any people here from Amsterdam? It's very close, the location is very close to Eye Center in Amsterdam. These are the original documents that I displayed. I borrowed from the International Institute of Social History in a glass box. And also some of them I enlarged to sort of create a more coherent with my own practice on the wall of the gallery space. This is a video we were looking at here. It's Kate Miller documentation of the 8th of March. It received interview by New York Times during the installation. And here in my last section of the presentation, I'm going to tell you the most exciting part of my project. This is the time that I left the historical part to a backdrop, and I started to find myself between these two worlds. The way in which I juxtapose these findings with personal, analytical, and imaginary dimension flourished a new body of work. I used to travel twice a year to Tehran. The constant back and forth exchange is also permanently present in this body of work. In between is this the title of this series of work. Even the project was started with the physical female body and the force of the physical veil, but I shifted to a more invisible form of veiling. I started to see a shifting pattern of exclusion and inclusion, which was no longer a dichotomy of veiled, unveiled, us, them, out, outdoor, indoor, rather a juxtaposition of all those, a moment in between all those, a double agency, a form of diasporic formation. I realized that the physical veil might have been forced on women through religious or political power, but the gesture, behaviors, and world views attached to years of wearing or not wearing the veil cannot be transformed so easily, and definitely not overnight. I continued to dig more on this when I realized a text by Farzan Nemilani. I'm going to show you a text. They have been weighed and unweighed by force, but they will remain unfolded and covered by physical and psychological traces of their moods of acceptances or rejections of the way. It was a true feeling to read this. It was me among different metaphorical forms of veiling, which is a language, behavior, and many others which are not traceable similar to its physical form. It was here that I was nominated for a funding residency at the Swedish Arts Grants Committee to develop my research further. Here you can see some of the images of the estate in between. Is anyone from Sweden here? Swedish? No? You can see some of the work here. This is how the project started to develop as the moment in between. Am I okay with the time? As you can see, some of the images are indoor, some of them are studio shots, and some of them are outdoor in Tehran or in London. It's a combination of the fragments that I was experiencing through this project. So the history became a backdrop, and I started to sort of magnify the moments that I was exploring. Here, as you can see, there is a 3-channel video constantly played next to those images that are still on the wall. Apart from the vines, which are for the guests, the rest was installed for the exhibition. This is part of my PhD examination. I received unconditional pass. It's a distinction. It's first in RCA after 20 years. So I was very proud and pleased that the theoretical written one. I put some of the images that you can see from the close-up. It is the moment in between. So if I just go in one, each of the ones, you could probably try to experience, I hope. These are moments of installation, which I always think as part of a curatorial or artistic practice. I like my audience to be part of it. It's not not just the finished work, also the preparation. I normally print out some of the images during the preparation to be shared for the day of the final. Following those experiments, I did a day symposium at Yaspis in Stockholm, speakers including Petra Bauer, Athena Farrokhzad, and Sister of Jam. The title of the project was Feminist Historiography, and the aim was to expand the feminist history of Iran within more global context. Are you familiar with the work of Petra Bauer in Venice Biennale last round? She did this research at the pavilion, and her work is dedicated to archives by early feminists in Sweden. Have you? Yeah. As part of this program, I had a performance and a screening at the Index Foundation for Swedish Art. The performance was called The Dining Table with Azadeh, let me bring the names. That was the title of the project, which was a combination of a few public programs. Similar to the showroom, it was a combination of symposium, exhibition, a screening. This is a screenshot, this is a photo of the performance. The copyright is for Alvaro Campo Studio and is in collaboration with Asa Seder Swiss, Emily Johnson, Joanna Lombard, and Shanna Mullen. I wrote a script by looking at writing and poems in relation to sociopolitical changes of concerning women's life. I started to work with the artists, rehearsing and sort of doing notation and a score for the text. I found female voice a great metaphor, pretty powerful and strong. And I enjoyed the polyphony of the voice, and I found the medium as a suitable property for the stage of in between. Here I'm going to play for you part of the performance while I would remain on the still image. Perhaps if you would like to, you could close your eyes to let this voice embrace you, but also I can send you the video later to watch it without, just so I don't feel comfortable being present.
Would rise from the prayer rug like pillars soaring into the sky,
above sadness,
above storm, to the height of creativity, to the pinnacle of heaven, then again to the depths of submission.
She always smelled of jasmine and never arbored any bulbs as to a choice of perfume.
It is grandmother I'm talking about. It is grandmother I'm talking about.
She knew with astonishing confidence that her life story would bust but her destiny, that she had in her own hand the key to eternity. She even knew that if she wanted, she could summon the prophet Shasr to demand of him whatever she desired.
And how generous he was. Grandmother's green clothed phantasm. Magnanimous, bearer of plenty without anger, without guile. Beyond needs, beyond expectations, with his blessings and gifts flowing free like the waters of an endless stream.
She always smelled of jasmine and wore black shoes that shined, crowned with a ribbon on top.
I'm telling you about my grandmother.
No one is thinking about the flowers.
No one is thinking about
the
flowers.
No one is thinking about the fish.
No one is thinking about the fish.
No one wants to believe
that the garden is dying.
That the garden's heart is swollen under the sun. That the garden's mind is slowly being raised of green memories.
And the garden senses
are sensing our symbol in a corner.
Huddled in a corner.
Our old orchard is lonely.
No one.
Our garden yawns in anticipation of an unknown rain cloud.
No one.
Stars fall to the earth from the tree-topped heights, and from the pale windows of the fish's abode.
The sound of hopping comes in the night. I want your garden is lonely. Father says, it's too late for me. It's over for me. I shouldered my burden and I did my share. And in his room, from dawn to dusk, he reads either the Shamane or the history of histories. Father says to mother,
mother,
to hell with all birds and fish,
mother.
There is two books publication coming out for 2017 as part of this project. One is a monograph and the other one is a collective one. The first one is doing my PhD thesis by Ivy Towers publication, and then the showroom project in sponsored by Prince Claus Fund in Amsterdam. Well, I'm going to stop here and thank you for listening, and I'm curious to hear your questions, your reflections. It would be great if you could raise your hand, share your opinion. Here, as I promised, is my email. Any of those links you were interested, just drop me a line and I'm more than happy to share it with you. It is the most important part of our research is dissemination. It is important to share. And thank you for being here. Thanks.
Great. I think get some lights on. So I think thank you very much for that, Azadeh, for that comprehensive kind of overview, starting with that initial image, which you said that you kind of discovered that kind of came to that image, you know, in this lecture theatre,
yes.
And it's taking on this journey in tracing and responding to the archive images of around. Movement in Iran and in the historical movement, and then and kind of taking it internationally. I wondered just to start off whether you could maybe say a bit more about your about the conclusions of your research. What is it that you think, having you know taken on that journey from that single image to making works that responded, and it, you, obviously you were using found images, you were using archival images. Looked at some of the images in the photograph, as though you made images, you constructed photographs, used performance.
Sure.
You know, what were the kind of main sort of conclusions that you drew from the research? What was the kind of, so your starting point with this image, what was the kind of, what do you think you discovered
in
the world?
That's right, thanks, Paul. That's a very interesting question. It's right, it's begun with that image, single still image. It sort of, for me, was not familiar, and I didn't know about that part of history, but it became part of my own history as a woman of Iran, and then it became part of me being in a different context, because me encountering that in Chelsea College, and then developing that in an ivory tower of another art school, which is not in Iran, it's in Britain. If I was not here, I wouldn't see that, and if I was not at there was a certain support and platform to expand the project. Of course, here I did the Empress, so that helped me a lot to maintain. figure out what was that history behind it exactly, because I was not anymore trusting any news or media representation. I wanted to find first-hand people who were involved. As you could see, I did a series of interviews, or I did a field work in different archives to find registered images that are reality that could help me. And then I was curious. So this was a spontaneous 6 days demonstration that Kate Miller says is first and it's kind in feminist history of the world. But why spontaneous? What was it so important that you feel yourself obliged to be part of? So then I had to go back to the, because the history of that day, there is a moment before and after. I'm living in the after one, but I was curious to know what is before and how those could create the history that I was searching for. But I was not in a social science department, I was in the fine arts, school of fine art.
I guess that was part of my question.
Yes.
Because obviously there's a kind of documentary component to
the
project, but it's also a kind of more creative imagining of.
Imaginary, yes. There is analytical documentary, there is a section to that, but in almost the last year, I dropped all those to a form of, as a studio photography, to a backdrop. And then I started to use fragmented images or abstraction that could reflect on more of a, maybe a form of aesthetic, because also the current situation of women covering is no longer protest, is a sort of, I call it in my thesis as a aesthetic of resistance, is a form of a beauty as well as the resistance. So it has that femininity to it. So I start to play with drapery, the falling, the moment in between, or I started to work with the films by Iranian director Lakshmi Nishat or Mahmoud Wolf. I started to work with them, space of architectural space around. I have a chapter in my thesis called Mobile Architecture, which looks at the space that surrounds waiting as a form of mobile architecture, that a private space is constantly carried with you. And the woman constantly occupies a private within the public. And there is a French word, Bertrand, I think it identifies a very intimate private room, dressing room for a woman. Would you, is that right? Would you?
Would you?
I think that's the name in French that entitled a space for a private space for women that is a dressing room for women.
Oh, boudoir, sorry.
Oh, thank you.
Boudoir.
Yeah, we said boudoir.
Thanks for that pronunciation. Yeah, that's, so I started to work with that. And of course, like Adolf Loos has this, there is a context of gaze and alien system of looking in Iranian urban setting within that covering. So I start to work on that with this space of a woman body, which I came across with a similar work of architecture with Adolf Loos for the building he designed for Josephine Baker's The Singer. And it was not made, but it was apart from other work of him. It was sort of creating an alien system of looking, which the viewer was the main authority of the looking in that space, which was a sort of swimming pool and a few different glasses when you would enter the space. It wouldn't be in the scope of this this event to go about it, but there, I have a conference organized in the RCI in 3rd of February. If you are interested, it looks at the space in between in this architectural or environmental psychological. Again, please drop me a line and I forward it. And I think it's also in your website, CCW website, the details is out there.
Could you wait till we get the microphones and we're recording this event, by the way?
Azadeh, can we go back to that image from the beginning of the century, the 1908? Way back. From the early feminist thing. That one there. I'm wondering what veiling means here, because it's fascinating, because it reminded me of the Wilkie Collins Woman in White, where you get this drama of drapery and this idea of drapery as agency, which you mentioned a minute ago, you know. Yeah. You also get it, of course, in films. Often drapery has a kind of corny message. You know, where it's about subtly indicating that lovemaking may be going on somewhere else. But in this instance, I'm wondering what this woman's drapery means here. I don't know.
Thanks, Malcolm. Answering your question, this is the copy of the journal of A Woman's Voice, which is produced by her, Sabina Dolas, who studied in Sorbonne during that time. It's held in the International Institute of Social History. It's interesting that it's about 84 copies, and all of them have the same cover page. So it was one stencil still that could produce these images. So the reproduction of that is constantly one figure that is present. It's not an Iranian context, it's definitely a Western image that is represented.
Yes.
Jen Doy, which is a lecturer at UCLA, has a book on drapery and discovers or sort of analyzes this image more comprehensively on the form of art historian perspective. She was my external examiner, one of my external examiners. And maybe I should refer to her to answer this question, but for me also is a reference to beauty, as you said, is a reference to aesthetic, is those layers of fabric, which in my writings I have also have anecdotes of my memories when my grandmother was making veil. So I have this written text, which when you read creates that third image for you, which is describing how my mother was standing on the stove when my grandma would try on her the newly cut out veil, so to do the final touch. When she would put that cover on her head, it was like an oily gray thing was falling. It was a very beautiful fall for me to look at that drapery, but that is also part of the anecdotes that are in my writings that reflect on this beauty that has been part of this project. Not sure if I answered directly to your question, but these are my
thoughts. I wonder, because obviously it's a Western image, but it's in an Iranian context, and I'm just wondering what this does to transform or to affect the notion of veiling. I don't know.
It has done. If you look at his work, you could see similarities. You could see sort of fragmented version of those, or here, and of course abstracted here. But it has that sense of beauty. And she was coming from Sorbonne. Within that context, she's translating works and context within that topic of feminism from there. She was the first woman speaker in the Congress of Women in Paris. And so these are, maybe given that context, would identify where the image is coming from. Surely it's not Iranian, as we all agree, but that's what I would add.
Yeah, Azadeh, thank you so much. It's really interesting. Of course, for me, it's very painful because I was part of the whole, you know, one of those women who went out there.
You're much younger.
Well, I'm not going to tell you my age. But yeah, it's very interesting research. And I think in answer to Malcolm's question, I think something popped into my mind, and I think it's very relevant to the kind of research that you're doing. I think, from my perspective, I find this quite difficult as someone who's experienced the whole revolution and also kind of sees feminism far happening way before the names that you've mentioned. And I'm wondering whether the feminism you refer to, the Iranian feminism that you refer to, is about a Western feminism imported to Iran, and what you're looking at and you're referring to is a Western feminism or kind of representation of feminism within Iranian context. And I think I find that fundamentally problematic. And I think I would probably kind of look at a whole range of feminist activities, actions that our women in Iran are taking, the whole kind of effect that the revolution had on women's employment in Iran at this moment, which would be contradictory to the kind of feminism that you're actually talking about here.
Yeah, sure. I answer your question in two parts. One is, first of all, the feminism in Iran, in my opinion, has three movements. One is constitutional revolution by 1906 to 11, which was the rise of the feminism in Iran, which was led by those women who studied abroad and go back. It's if you want to compare that with first wave, second wave, or third wave of feminism in abroad, that's a different story.
Yes.
But for me to categorize my research was the three particular moments in the history of feminism in Iran, which was constitutional revolution, 1979 revolution, and then green movement, 2009. Each of these identifies a specific moment in history and a specific sort of criteria for women's rights, women activism, and their right for divorce, their right for childcare, all of those that you are considering as. But one of my major projects for analyzing this history was to take on two moments that are veiling and unveiling in the history of feminism in Iran. 1936, women were forcibly unveiled. 1979, they were forcibly veiled. There is always considered the 1979 as a violence towards women, but I'm afraid that academically, the analysis goes back to the parallel violence towards women, because 1936 was also considered a violence towards women. There are many texts by Iranian writers that refer to the harassments and the physical attack to women who were unveiled, uncovered in the street. And for them that who were wearing that for many years traditionally was considered as being naked in the street. It was a shock, or many of them decided to no longer go outside anymore. But it was a grassroots movement to start with. And for many was a celebration of feminism, because it was actually giving chance for women to be outside the doors. In global context, for me, those first 2 years, I was purely focused on Iranian history. The third year, I expanded to the relation to feminism abroad, and I presented paper in different conferences to attract that, to cover that area, the challenges of contemporary feminism, third wave feminism, or the other areas that could be relevant within the second wave or third wave feminism globally. And on my fourth year, as you could see in Stockholm, I started to cover similar path that women's community took place in the early feminist movement, whether in Sweden or in Iran, or maybe in Britain. So there is a conference, 2 days international conference, is sponsored by British Institute for Christian Study. I'm organizing in September this year, 2017. It goes over these three sections I just talked about very extensively, and it will be published in London. So if you can't make it to that event, there is a publication due around that. So you can refer to that comprehensively and in response to its global parallel movement, which is also, there is another circle to look into, which is Middle Eastern feminism, which is post-colonial feminism, which is all of this that overlaps. Of course, I had to be very selective. I was not going to stay in RCA forever. I had to graduate, so I had to wrap it up. But that's maybe I could offer this as an answer.
So it would be very interesting to actually kind of look at it in these different contexts.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. It needed a different department, I could tell you, because I'm part of the School of Fine Arts, and as an artist, you of course you can collaborate, you can cooperate, and you can expand with the different social science or other cultural studies departments. But to provide a work that could be evaluated by School of Fine Art, you need to be practice based or provide something that could be more experimental or imaginary in writing and also in practice. But we can talk afterwards if you like.
Yes,
more. I would be delighted. Yeah. Sure.
Thank you very much for your interesting
Thanks.
Presentation. Before asking my question, I have to say I'm sorry for my lack of knowledge about Iran, and I'm afraid my question might be a little bit irrelevant to your concern, or it doesn't make sense. Well, Could you let us know about the ethnic composition of Iran? Because you think there is any the influence of ethnic difference on the Iranian feminist movement? I'm asking this because in Japan there was a similar feminist movement. I think it is true that the movement made huge contribution to the promotion of women's status in Japan. But on the other hand, in my opinion, it also kind of enforced the gap between Japanese women and women in the other ethnicities such as Korean, Chinese, or other Southeast Asian countries who were derived from the history of Japanese colonialism. I think this is one of the biggest reasons why kind of sexual wartime crime done by Japanese government, such as the issue of comfort women, has not been regarded as a important issues. So I just wondering the ethnic composition of Iran and its influence or connection, both negative or positive, the influence on the movement.
Excellent question. Can I just add to that?
Sure.
Class component as well,
mm-hmm.
in terms
sure.
of what was the kind of class composition of the movement. I mean, you talked outside of this context on focusing
sure,
on middle
sure.
class women.
Sure, sure.
What about
yeah.
the yeah.
And Julia Crystal has a book on that, on the Chinese feminist movement and her contribution to that. As far as I'm familiar, is through her writing, Crystal. But also, ethnicity diversion in Iran is not as cosmopolitan as over here, it's very limited. But class is very important text and section to mention, because Nancy Fraser has written the text about public and pubic, the relation between Orange to be a man, to be able to speak, or if you can speak as a woman in a sort of bourgeoisie context or Western democratic context. And it also similar in Iran. Most these women who have studied abroad are not middle class women, they're upper class women who could maintain the lifestyle of going abroad in that time. And so we are talking about the feminism who is raised within the upper class community. And it's been supported. So the Women Organization of Iran, which stands for WOI, which was the first organization after the one that Dolat Abadi established, was supported by the sister of the Shah, which is the king of the country. So it was an upper class movement. It was a bourgeoisie creation. It was not a grassroots of. It was not a grassroots of middle class. Students. No, it was an upper class bourgeoisie. I'm writing a text on this in relation to Nancy Fraser, public, pubic, and the idea of democracy in public space. We refer to that because in Middle East we refer to what exists over here. But how does this could be obtained back there or accommodated with the reference to what was available, for instance, in Iranian context? It's not completed, but I would appreciate if you could leave me your email and I can send you the draft if when it's ready. It's going to be in the journal, Feminist Review, but I'm happy to share it with you when it's ready.
Does that answer a question? Yeah. So, there's a hand up there before coming to Maria. And David, that's it.
Thank you.
If you've got a question, please raise your hand. And it would be great if we have questions as well.
Thanks so much, Azadeh, for your presentation. You know, I've followed your research for some time, and it's wonderful to see how you've advanced your project, particularly in relation to the latest developments in relation to the aesthetic work and the way that's had resonances, as I can see, internationally. It's really, really wonderful to see. I want to take you back, though, to some of the earlier part of the work that I know a bit better, and that's the work you're talking in relation to historiography,
sure.
And particularly this found photograph. And my question's about the document, because it seemed to me that in that earlier part of your research, you were looking at the document in its, if you like, its conventional work, which is the work of providing proof. So we can see that there was the proof of something that actually took place. But it did seem to me that as your research progressed, that you felt that there was a limitation to the work of the document as providing proof, that you wanted something else from it. And in answer to an earlier question, you talked about that as something aesthetic, that you were looking for an aesthetic. So I just wanted to ask you about that moment where you tired, perhaps, or what happened around the document and why you felt that you no longer wanted to treat it as a historical proof-giving tool and wanted to do something else with it. What was that about? What happened there?
Sure, that's a very interesting question. And it's a spot on very core part of my project when I shifted. Thank you for your question and thank you for being here. First, for me, in the beginning was trusting nothing other than existing image. So if there was no image, I would not accept any written history. So images became the only evidence that I could trust. And I would show to different people, to different age group of women. I would visit Tehran twice a year and I would sit down with my friend's grandmother. So I would make a list before I go to definitely sit down and interview. Sometimes I wouldn't say I'm interviewing them because I wouldn't use those. I just wanted to have a backup that I could refer to. But also I wanted them to speak freely. So I wouldn't say, and I would put my phone on the recording. Just that to match them up and see, did she also say the same thing or it was different? So photos were the evidence. Photos were my only evidence that I came to know. Oh, no, we did 6 days demonstration. It was not just they accepted the veil. This was, and how much lie I was told 25 years living in that country. And so it was a shock. So I stayed with it very strongly. I visited a different archive to be sure this is a correct version. And also interviews. Then I was invited to, you probably know Clementine Delis. She was based in London, but for the time I'm talking about, she was the director of Weltkulte Museum. She invited me for a project there in the archive, photographic archive. I had the most privileged time over there. I was living in an apartment above the archive in the museum, 24 hours access to the material. Many of those nights I was opening these boxes of photos which were meant to be digitalized in the next few years, but there was no budget. So I was feeling being in my grandmother's basement and looking at this data which has no details. So I had to guess, this could be this, or according to this form of fashion, it could be this time. So David, I started to write fiction then. I started to write the stories of those characters, like, this could be that grandma of, for example, Sarah, she was talking about. So I created a new stage theater of all of those images, and it was piled. So when Clementine would visit me, like, I said, what are you doing? These are like writings, you should make something. And it became making, but it was the transition of what you were talking about happened in that basement in Weltkulte Museum. Museum of Culture of the World in Frankfurt, Germany. And I still remember those nights, how wonderful it was to shift from the fact to imaginary and creating all those theater crew in my photos and creating those moving images out of it. And so I started to make artist book. I started to play with those images. I had Victor Bergen's tutorial for a few sessions in RCA, as it was requested. And so I could work with him on creating a more, because I was writing long texts, and he was very critical on, what does that say? What does that say next to this image? Maybe the image is enough for this paragraph, cut that. So I had a few sessions to sort of create a more clear or perhaps cl- classic Victor Bergen's style of writing takes ultimately. I succeeded that, and happily we did a symposium together called Production of Image. So he, with his empire of writing on images, presented his fabulous presentation on those, and I went on with my student work of how I'm practicing that. Yeah, going back to your question, that happened in Frankfurt, and that was incredible transition in my work. Then I couldn't come out of it anymore, so there I am here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So there's a question here, and then Miriam, if you have a question.
Sure. Is the bar downstairs still working?
Is the
bar? There was a bar.
Bar. Oh, I see.
The pub. When we were sitting in here, the downstairs was a bar when we entered the thing. No?
Not this evening, I don't think.
Not anymore.
No.
Yeah.
Maybe.
I don't know. Okay.
Are you okay for a few more questions?
Of course. Yeah. No, I was just checking. No, sorry.
Well, we can continue this conversation at the bar. You know,
no,
let's have a few more questions.
Yeah, please. No, I'm so grateful that you're here, and I would love to hear your comments.
I'll be
checking. Hi, thank you so much. That's been a really interesting presentation. I'm currently doing a dissertation on the Iranian modernist movement and how it works in terms of the globalized context. And I'd really like to bring in the idea of the globalized historiography of feminism into it as well. And I was wondering if you can tell me about any Iranian women artists who you've come across, who and what kind of subjects they explore within the period before the 1979 revolution?
For sure. First, I would really like you to leave your email for me, so we can continue it in depth. Which era are you working on?
I'm trying to focus a bit more narrowly on the Sakakani movement. I'm going to focus on the Sakakani movement and kind of like the late 1950s up to the 1979 revolution.
Yes, sure. Do you mind if I just email you their names?
Yeah,
because we also have many writers that were very critical during that time that created the first fiction writing by women was published in 1946. And that's a fantastic work by Simin Danishvar. I can send you a copy of PDF in English. And that has inspired many artists which currently works on, like Shirin Nishat or other Iranian artists that I worked with contemporary ones that are based in Iran or abroad. I can introduce you to a few that could be maybe interesting for your work. And I would be more than happy to provide you with those details.
Maybe you could speak a little bit about what kind of practice this movement was for, because I'm quite curious now.
I'm curious.
Yes, tell us about it.
Sure. So the Sakakani movement was a movement within the Iranian modernist movement, which started arguably quite early in the 20th century. And it was a movement which ended up focusing on artists during the time who created artwork that included motifs of both Islamic and pre-Iranian art in a sort of modernist language kind of way. So basically I'm trying to argue that you should be able to view Iranian modernist art within a globalized context in a sense that it's not othered in terms of the West. So this was kind of some obstacles I'm coming across.
There was an exhibition 2015 March in Aisha House in New Cavendish Road in London. Have you seen that?
No.
So that was specifically, Aisha House shares the same building with Iran Heritage Foundation, which is specifically related to whatever is related to Iran culture and heritage, which was dedicated to modernism paintings. The painters were not women, were men, but the interesting view on that was very critical. And also, there's a curator at Tate called Murad Muntazami. He is a trusted Middle Eastern curator of, which is based at Tate Modern. 2 weeks a month he's in London, 2 weeks in Pompidou in France, Paris, and I can also put you in touch with him. He did a few writings on that. He has a couple of articles on modernism. The name is, fine, I'll write it for you.
Yeah.
Which is,
just in relation to that larger global moment, I mean, we actually met in Sharjah.
Exactly.
In the last meeting, and David was there as well.
Yeah.
Just really before I go to your question, just in relation to that, I mean, from what I could see in Sharjah, knowing the work of the Sharjah Art Foundation, there is a kind of reassessment of modernism and a kind of Arab modernism. So there's been shows around El Salahi, there's been shows around a well-known Sudanese female painter recently. There's lots of reassessments of modernism going on from that region. And I wonder whether your research has, you talked a lot about your references have been kind of Western references, or feminist writers, etc. In terms of what's happening in that region, what kinds of debates have you found interesting or not interesting?
Sure.
Would that be beyond the scope of your research?
No,
you say can we focus on
No, Paul, it's very much in the scope of my. During my MA here, I was looking at the work which was published by Ineva called The Veil, and had a text by a few artists, writers. One was Janan Al-Ani.
Curated by David Bailey.
Yes.
Yes,
curated.
And
one
of the creators, and Gillian Tuwatra.
Yes, of course. And
over four, sorry.
Yes, so that was my reference book. That was my reference book that I was started looking at. So I started to meet with Janan, with Zainab Sadira, and Shirin Nesha when she visited. She had a professorship in Oxford University Humanities Department 3 years ago. So I had a few meetings with her over many dinners. I could develop an understanding of what they have gone through as a woman abroad and Middle Eastern woman abroad and successful artists with your artists. And primarily, I think these three were my main contact. But of course, that has developed to a much larger community of artists that I've been inspired by and working with. Mani Akbari, I really admire her work. I was part of her project in the Ruskin School in November. So if I want to name a few that I've been working on outside Iran, these are the ones which are sort of medicine.
Great. Did you have a question?
I've got so many questions. Why that bar is so relevant. just to come back to you, there's we do have a lot of ethnicity. I mean, Iran is just so from east to west to south to north. I mean, we've got it all. I mean, I can say at least within the northern region of Iran, we've got Turkmens, got
Maria, let me talk
so something. Many. Just one little thing. So in terms of ethnicity, there's lots of different kind of cloth or clothing and ethnicity and kind of ideas behind that. But also, I think what would be interesting is, in relation to what you were saying, the biggest difference is not regional, is not necessarily to do with ethnicity, but is to do with region and capital. And I think Azadeh already pointed out at the fact that these women you can see is founder of, I would say, Western feminism, are mostly upper class, and from capital. A lot of that hardly happened. I know you've had a photograph from Gilan, which is north of Iran, in the earlier, prior to the new kind of women's movement.
Sure.
So yeah, if you could just say something about region and capital, that would be really interesting. Thank you.
There was a similar moment as I answered today with David's question that I left these dichotomies of capital and regional. I went to a space that are not categorized at all. Because I was traveling abroad and I was meeting Iranians who have lived outside when we were talking, they were from different generation. They were not back in Iran for 30 years. And what we had in common was a certain cultural barriers which were no longer from Iran, because they were not even living there. But they were barriers. They were not visible veil, but they were certain cultural behavior, invisible barriers that exist. That was the moment I expanded this to a more of a womanhood abroad, but more of a womanhood which is maybe it started within Islamic culture or Middle Eastern culture, but it is scattered around the world and it has different shades of gray in each individual. So I no longer stand for an Iranian woman, purely Iranian. I have been influenced by so many different understandings, and I cannot stand the dichotomies in my project and my being. So answering your on the side of capital, well, yeah, feminism started as a bourgeoisie practice also in Sweden, also in Britain and Dutch. So it started as a bourgeoisie movement. I have work of a video of Kate Miller Farm, which was a community farm that she established with her writings money, that women around the world could go there and do some building work and agriculture and stay there and write. So there is a community of women who are passionate to do things about the feminism, but the primary source of that is a class of bourgeoisie. It began with that, and we can't. Well, of course, Tehran is been the center for those in Iran, but when I traveled, I realized that doesn't have that heaviness for me anymore. And I've met those founders, which are scattered in the world. One is in Washington, one is in Berlin, and they are ordinary people in those cultures, you see? So I don't know how to say this, but I don't want to divide it to two at all. I'm not in that moment. I'm in this shifting pattern, and I like to stay there. I'm in between, and I like to stay there. Me too. Yeah.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, of course. You need the mic.
Could you wait? Could you wait for the mic so we can hear you? Thank you.
I would like to know if you are interested at all in bringing your research to Iran, or if you have done that, how the reception there was, maybe not necessarily by male governmental voices, but like more contemporary feminist voices.
Sure.
How they, what kind of input they gave you, or how they deal with your kind of research?
Sure, it belongs to them. And at the moment, I'm working with British Council for the online bilingual platform of my research, which could be shared with people in Iran, with women of my age and older, younger. I want the new generation to know about it. But physically taking this work to Iran, I don't think it's possible at the moment. It was removed from history book. I grew up 26 years in Iran, and I didn't know about it. So it would not be a pleasant appearance of this project. Not just for the consequences of it, but it would have all this effort buried on the soil I'm picking. So why would I do that? I would rather like it to be shared. And the only way I could go about it so far is this funding from British Council Art Iran section, which sponsored this bilingual online platform, Farsi English. It was forced to be Arabic, but I couldn't, so it's Farsi English. And they could access it from Tehran and every other places, so that I can share, could know about it, and I could share what I've done about it, and many others who have done about it, but because it's not in one place, or I could provide links to their work, so it could be a platform for that project. This is in progress at the moment. Publication will be in Farsi. The one I have done with the showroom is in bilingual, so it will be produced in Farsi. If they can send it up to Tehran, it will be fantastic, so they can have a copy. not sure about this distribution, it would not be an easy, welcome distribution. Showing this work in Iran, I would love to do the exhibition of the showroom in Iran. I have so many places there to do it. I can just send a file and do it virtually. But I'm not sure. I'm not going to now visit Tehran twice a year, every 6 months, I myself. And I'm not sure that's a safe move to take unless we want to go home.
Online would be great, doesn't it? I think that's a great idea to actually start something online so that
it is
Iranian feminists will get on there. They would want to contribute, they will challenge you, they will add to it. I think it is so exciting. I really can't wait to see that.
Sure. It's
wonderful.
It is
happening.
I look forward to that.
Sure.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Well, on that immensely optimistic note, or, you know, online virtual possibilities of extending this project. I mean, as someone who's works in curation, you can talk about the curatorial aspects of your work as well, which sort of can is another mode of dissemination, another way of doing. Anyway, I'd like to thank everyone for coming. Just quickly before we close, ask you to do the really boring thing, spend 2 minutes filling in these really boring forms. It helps us get feedback. Leave your email so we can kind of add you to our list if you're not on our TrAIN mailing list for our events. And it remains to me just to thank Azadeh for a wonderful presentation that showed really the richness of your research. Obviously we'll hear more about that with the Diaspora platform project that you're involved in, which is also a UN project. So thank you so much.
Thanks very much.